Welcome to another edition of North Shore Journal. I'm your host, Walt Kosmowski. And I'd like to introduce my guest today, and my guest is Jake Cavanaugh. Jake, welcome.
Thank you very much for having me.
Yeah. And Jake is with an organization called the NAN Project. And before we get into our discussion, I just want to hold up their little brochure that they have here for the NAN Project. And I'm going to read off. It says mental health awareness and suicide prevention, and I'm just going to read a little bit from the front side here. An initiative to increase understanding, support, and treatment of mental health concerns in young people. And before we get into specifically about the NAN Project, in order to kind of set the tone here for our viewers, maybe we can talk about suicide. And I believe you've told me that it's one of the leading causes of death in the United States. Tell us about suicide deaths in the United States.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, mental health is an issue we really don't talk about a lot. And suicide definitely is something that's not brought up in most conversations. But it is the 10th leading cause of death in the United States. And in 2017, the most recent year that we have numbers for, over 47,000 Americans ended their life by suicide.
So of any kind, diseases or car accidents or whatever, it's the 10th largest cause. So that's significant. That's quite significant. And if you narrow that down, Jake, into young people, let's say from 10 to 24,
it's the second leading cause of death.
Leading cause of death for people between 10 and 24.
And it's something that I found incredible once I saw that statistic. Because again, it's not something you ever talk about.
Yeah.
It's not something you ever think about, especially as a kid.
Yeah. And the holy cow, I guess, is that figure has risen how much in the last 10 years?
Well, I know just in the past year, it's gone up by 5%.
By 5%.
Which is incredible. Yeah. In the past 10 years, it's gone up from probably about 30 to 40%.
Yeah. So if you think about that, that's incredible. So there's something happening in the last few years, perhaps, you know, our kind of anxieties of our society and depression and things like that. Now, and I think it's reaching, from what you've told me before, it's reaching deeper and deeper into younger and younger people. So tell us about high school students and depression in high school students.
So we know that at least 25% of young adults in high school will struggle with depression at some point in their high school career. Mm-hmm. And that's self-reporting off the Youth Risk Behavioral Survey. Mm-hmm. That number could actually be a bit higher because, again, it is self-reporting, and there are young adults who don't really understand what depression is or don't want to admit that they are struggling themselves. So it could be higher, like 30 or 35%. Yeah.
They might not even know that they're experiencing depression.
Yep.
So they might not even know that that if you ask them to say, are you depressed? I don't know. But, and I think there's a misconception about, is suicide preventable? And I think you have some information or some statistics about that, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely preventable. If you know the signs, if you know how to reach out to a friend who might be struggling and intervene before they get to that crisis point, we know suicide is absolutely preventable. We know that 90% of people who attempt suicide and survive never go on to attempt again. So that number just shows you that there's a lot of ambivalence when people are thinking about suicide, thinking about taking their own life. It's often not that they want to die, but that they can't see a reason to live in that really dark moment that they're in.
Yeah. And it's almost like if 90% never try it again, it's almost as if they're saying, I don't really want to die, but I want someone to notice me. I want someone to talk to me, or I want to
get some... That's absolutely right. And that is kind of one of the biggest steps you can take if you are concerned about someone, is reaching out, making that human contact, and showing them that you care, that you notice what's going on with them, and that you'll be there with them to get them to the supports that they need.
Yeah. And that brings me to a question, because there seems to be a myth out there that if you talk to someone about suicide, that will put the idea in their head. Can you talk about that?
Right. There is such stigma around suicide that people think if you bring up the word suicide in a conversation, you might plant that idea in someone's head. We know that's absolutely not true. Talking about suicide, asking someone that you're concerned about if they're thinking about suicide, will not put the idea in their head. In fact, it'll actually show the person that you are open to having that difficult conversation, that you're not scared to talk about what can be a really scary topic, that you're willing to be with that person while they're struggling, and you're willing to get that person to help.
Yeah, and I think that you can extrapolate that to other mental health challenges that I think you gave me a figure, or maybe you can share that with our audience about people who suffer from, let's say, depression and are treated. What happens there?
It is absolutely treatable. Depression, if you get the right treatments, be that therapy, be that medication, be that learning coping strategies, depression is treatable. We know that 80 to 90% of people that get the proper treatment, whatever combination of those supports that it is, do see improvement, and they can go on to live very happy and healthy and productive lives.
Yeah. So that would the two statistics about the suicide and about this, the depression would really augur for early intervention and contact and that's.
But that only happens if we feel comfortable talking about what these topics are and getting it out in the open and making that conversation something that we all feel comfortable having.
Yeah. So that brings us to the NAN project, okay, specifically. And I know I'd like you to tell our audience, because you've had a personal experience with suicide which caused you and your mom to form the NAN project. Why don't you tell our audience about that?
Absolutely. So I lost my sister to suicide in early 2012, almost 7 years ago. My sister Nan had struggled from probably a very young age with depression, anxiety, obsessive compulsive disorder. And looking back now, there are a lot of signs that she was struggling with mental illness. But at the time, we didn't know what it was. I have two other sisters. My parents saw that Nan was struggling with something that we didn't have. It was small things, like she would have trouble getting out of bed in the morning, or getting her into school every day became really, really difficult. And they would tell the doctors about this, and through no fault of their own, the doctors would say, she's a kid, it could be a phase, she'll probably grow out of it. And by the time she was actually diagnosed, which was her sophomore year in high school, I think she had learned to put on a mask. I think she'd learned to cover up what she was going through. For anybody of any age to be told that you have a mental illness, that you have depression, that you have anxiety, I think is terrifying. But that's especially so if you're just getting into high school, if you're a 14 or 15-year-old young adult, and nobody's talking about mental illness. No one's in the locker room saying, I had a tough time getting out of bed today because of my depression, or I couldn't go into that science class today because my anxiety, I was having a panic attack. It's not something that's on Facebook. It's just not something that we talk about. And I think that's why she learned to cover up what she was going through. And Nan was, by all means, outwardly a happy-go-lucky kid.
Yeah.
She loved playing soccer. She would watch sports with me. Every Sunday, the Patriots. During the summer, the Red Sox. During the winter, the Celtics. She did well in school.
Yeah.
We went to Hamilton Wenham. And she got mostly A's and B's. She played on the soccer team. She got the Spirit Award her senior year. So I think for those around her, probably had no idea really what she was struggling with internally, emotionally. She went off to UMass Amherst, again, did very well. But I think she started to isolate more and more. She would rarely come home on breaks. I was living abroad at the time, and I used to be able to get her on the phone every week or every other week just to check in. And that stopped all of a sudden. And I think these were clear signs that she was still emotionally struggling with something very deep. But at the time, I had very little education about what depression was, so I didn't really fully understand what she was going through. Nan went to get her master's in social work at Westfield State University, and a month before she was going to graduate, she ended her life. And I think as a family, or specifically as a brother, you do a lot of soul searching. You wonder what you missed. You wonder, why wasn't I there for them? Why wasn't I able to support someone I cared so much about? And for me, it really came down to education. I didn't have the education about what depression was or what anxiety was. 20 plus years ago, when I was in high school, our health classes, we talked about sex ed. We talked about the dangers of drinking and driving, or don't smoke cigarettes because you get cancer. But mental health or mental illness just wasn't on the radar at that time. Yeah. I fortunately, working with schools now, we're starting to see that change. But I felt like I wasn't able to support my sister because I didn't understand what she was experiencing, what it meant to have a diagnosis, and more importantly, what was I supposed to do with that information if I did recognize the signs? And so that's kind of where the NAM project came from. We want to provide education to young adults in high school, and now we're moving into middle schools as well, about what is depression? What are the signs that a friend is struggling? And more importantly, what do you do if you notice those signs? And the way that we open up that conversation is we have a peer-to-peer model.
Tell us about that. Yeah.
Sure. We work with young adults who have struggled with various mental health issues, traumas, maybe sexual identity or sexual orientation. They've had struggles that every high schooler, if they don't experience themselves, they know a friend or they know a classmate that's going through that at some point. And we work with these incredible young adults. Most of them are 18 to 23 years old. We call them our peer mentors. And we help them craft a comeback story, where they talk about, what was it like to be 16 and having depression? Or what was it like to be 17 and struggling with an eating disorder? But more importantly, what were some of the supports that you were able to turn to in those difficult days, when you were having those really tough times? What were the resources that got you over the hump? How did you get to this amazing place where you are now? And we always end on a message of hope, talking about here's where they are now and here's where they see their future. Because I think for a lot of young people, if you are going through one of these struggles, you don't have the perspective to really understand that it can get better, that if you get the help that you need, you can do well and you can get through these difficult times.
Yeah. Now where did these peer mentors, where did they come from? Were they people that you coached before and have gotten better and now they're, how do you train them or where do they come from?
Great question. We're always actively recruiting new young people.
Yeah.
Our main criteria is that they're sort of in a safe space in their recovery, that they've gotten over the hurdles. Most of our young adults come through DMH-funded programs. The main one is called Gathering Inspiring Future Talent.
And what is GMH?
DMH, Department of Mental Health.
Okay.
And so a lot of our young people come through there or are referred to us through DMH caseworkers. Some are from the high schools that we present in, or young adults who kind of hear about us through friends. We're an open door. We really will work with any young adult who's sort of interested in getting out this message of mental health awareness and providing the suicide prevention programming that we do.
Now, do these people volunteer? Do you pay them or?
Our peer mentors are all paid. So we have a paid 4-day training that all of our peer mentors go through.
Mm-hmm.
We do regular coaching days where they get additional training, usually once a month, once every month. And a big part of that is learning about self-care. So we work with clinicians that come in and provide some supports because the work that we do and the work these incredible young people do, it can be tough. It can be really tough to talk about your own personal experience in front of maybe 4 classes in a day.
Right.
So it can be very taxing. So a big part of what we try and train is self-care and knowing how to take care of yourself.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned classes, you mentioned high schools, working with high schools. I take it that that's your main focus. So tell us about your work with high schools and maybe tell us what you do with some of the local schools around the Beverly area.
Okay. So primarily what our model looks like when we go into a high school is we'll have several of our peer mentors go in, tell their story, tell their experience, because this story is different from this story. And this story might be relatable to this group of students, but this young person's story might be relatable to this group of students. So we want to cover the most students as possible. So we'll usually start off with a couple of these comeback stories, and then we open up the discussion with the students. Usually they have a bunch of questions about either the stories in particular or about mental health related topics. And then we make sure we very clearly outline, here's what depression looks like, here's what to be on the lookout for in a friend who's struggling. And more importantly, here's what you do. Here are the three concrete steps that you can take if you're concerned about a friend. One, you check in with them. Two, you sit back and listen. You let them talk about what they're going through. And three, you get them to a trusted adult. We make sure that any student who hears our presentation understands that they need to take that information to a trusted adult. They're not clinicians. They're not trained to deal with that. The best thing they can do to help their friend is get to a trained adult. Yeah. So we are now working with about 28 different schools all across Massachusetts, as far west as Westfield, up in Lowell, Methuen, down in Milford. We're constantly adding new schools, and we've done some work here, just started in Beverly.
Beverly High School, yeah.
We provided a suicide prevention training for staff back in December, and then we brought our peer mentors in to present to a health class in mid-April.
Okay, so I was going to ask you, so you go to the administration of the school and say, we would like to do this, and then what, you charge for this service, that you charge the school district for the service?
No. Our services are free of charge. Our goal is to get in front of as many students as possible, and we know that schools don't have a ton of extra money on hand. Typically, the way we get into a school is we'll have our peer mentors come in and present to a group of administration, maybe some health teachers, some PE teachers, just to kind of open the door and show them what this model looks like, and then we'll go into the health classes.
Right, so you usually go either in health classes or social studies classes or something.
Typically,
like that.
But we'll work with the school district kind of wherever they're at.
Yeah. Now, so where does the NAM project get its funding and its money, Jake?
So we kind of scrap it together wherever we can get. We do a lot of grant writing. We've been awarded 4 grants so far this year. We get some money from the Department of Mental Health. We've gotten project-specific funding from the Department of Public Health. But really, the backbone of our organization has been Elliott Community Human Services, which is a large behavioral health organization. And through them, they've provided us some clinical expertise. They've provided us with office space. They've just been a really wonderful organization for us to be affiliated with.
And tell us about Elliott. What are they? Who are they?
So they have emergency crisis response teams. They're emergency service providers, which are clinicians that can go out to schools, can go out to homes, help someone who's struggling with a mental health issue. They have residential homes for youth for older people. They really do provide a huge array of services across eastern Massachusetts.
Okay, and they provide you with funding, or they provide you with housing, or what?
A little bit of both.
Yeah.
We wouldn't be here without the support that Elliott has been providing us.
And you write, now who writes the grants that you were talking about?
So I do that. I have a colleague who works for the Massachusetts Society for Protection of Children. I think I got that wrong, but MSPCC.
Okay.
So they help us with some of the grant writing. But for the first several years, it was myself and Ellen Dalton, my mother, who also has been a big part of this.
Yeah. So you're pretty much a small. This is your full time gig, right?
This is
your
full time occupation. And we have 3 other 30 plus hour a week employees. 3 or 4 10 to 20 hour a week employees, and then about 25 peer mentors that work with us on a contract basis. So they get paid by the number of hours they work every week.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Now you were telling me earlier that there was a Netflix series talking about 13 Reasons Why. Mm, and yep. And you were mentioning to me that there was some misinformation, according to you, that they were. Can you tell us a little bit about that and how these things start and what kind of a misinformation maybe that you were able to spot?
Yeah, so when that series came out in mid-2017, we started to hear a lot of questions from teachers. They'd hear students talking about it. So eventually I went and watched it, and I actually found the series, it was at one time helpful in that it brought the topic of suicide to light and made it a conversation that you heard about on the radio, that you heard about on the nightly news. But at the same time, the series itself I found quite dangerous. Mm-hmm. First and foremost, they showed the suicide of the main character, Hannah, which is incredibly scary. It can be traumatic for someone who's lost someone or they themselves have attempted. But also, you're not supposed to show the means or the ways that people attempt suicide.
Yeah.
Two, it almost glorified someone's death by suicide. It gave the main character a voice after her death. And for someone who's struggling in high school, in middle school, and feels like no one's listening to them, it almost made it seem like, oh, hey, if I do this, then people will listen to me. Third, and this was also probably most important, it made all the resources and all the supports in Hannah's life seem either negligent or outright dangerous. She went to her guidance counselor and basically got rebuffed after being assaulted. Her friends almost encouraged her risky behavior. Her parents seemed aloof and out of touch. And for a young person who's struggling with depression, they might feel like, okay, so where do I turn to? There's nothing out there. We also found that they didn't talk about mental illness at all in the series. Mm-hmm. We know that 90% of, not just young people, anybody who dies by suicide is struggling with a mental health issue. And they made it seem like it had nothing to do with mental health. And we made this series to really emphasize, here are some of the risk factors that might go into someone who's thinking about suicide, be it someone self-harming or depression or anxiety. But more importantly, we tried to provide resources throughout these 13 vignettes that we produce, be it websites, be it call lines, be it people you could turn to if you were struggling. Mm-hmm. And then we really outlined some coping strategies you can employ if you're struggling or if you know a friend who's struggling. It's pretty easy, mundane stuff mm-hmm. that you could use to help yourself if you're in a tough situation. And then the last vignette touched on what I talked about before. What do you do if you're concerned about a friend? Here are three easy steps. Ask, listen, and get them to help.
Get help, yeah. Now, you mentioned that these vignettes can be seen. Where can someone access these vignettes you're talking about?
You can go to our website, thenamproject.org.
Yeah. Okay.
And there is a link to them on there. You can watch them either individually or as a full 45-minute long movie.
Okay, so we see up there thenanproject.org, and they can go on that website and see those vignettes.
Absolutely.
And also, that is a telephone number, and where will that ring, that telephone
That's
number?
My personal telephone
That's your phone number.
Number.
Okay.
So if you need to get in touch with me, if you're interested in bringing our programming to your school, we'd be more than happy to have a conversation with you. I want to emphasize that we are an education and awareness organization.
Mm-hmm.
We're not clinical.
You're not,
we're not the people you call if you're in crisis.
Right. Right. Okay, and now you also have your an email address,
yep.
right? So let's take a look. This is your own email,
so
right?
It's jkavanaugh@thenamproject.org.
Okay.
Again, send me an email if you're interested in having our young people come and present or talk to your group or school.
So it's J and C A V A N A U G H at the NAN Project. .org and that and you will answer that right away. And now you mentioned to me earlier that you had something called the question persuade refer model. What tell us a little bit about that?
So one of the services we offer is we provide suicide prevention training for staff at schools, for community groups, and for groups of students. It's all a little bit different, tailored to the different groups. But QPR, question persuade refer, it's a set of tools that someone who's not clinical can use to help a person, a friend, a stranger, whoever it might be, that might be struggling, that might be in crisis. And again, that goes back to the three easy steps that I was talking about.
Right.
question, you're checking in with them. You're asking that question, are you thinking about suicide? You're referring, which involves, persuading first. Yep. You're persuading that person to live. And that a lot of that is just kind of listening and validating what they're feeling. And then you're referring them on to that clinical person, to that support that can really get them the help that they need.
Yeah. Well, Jake, this has been a very interesting, very illuminating, and I think more and more now people are realizing a lot of these mental health issues and suicide or depression are starting at a much younger age in students and children. And as you so poignantly described with your sister, it was covered up. You didn't even know. There were just tiny little signs. But yep. She's a star athlete, and she's going for her master's degree.
Yeah.
So let's see if people want to get more information. Let's put your website up there. www.thenanproject.org. There's the phone number. And let's put up your email address as well. And Jay Kavanaugh and thenanproject.org. Well, very good. Well, Jake, thank you very much for sharing this information with our audience.
Well, I really appreciate the opportunity to be here and to sort of get this message out. And we really hope we can hear from more schools through this.
Yeah. Well, good luck to you in that endeavor. Thank you. And I'd like to remind our viewers that you've been watching North Shore Journal. I'm your host, Walt Kosmowski, and we'll see you next time.